of the Press, the program where we tell you about the headlines and make sense of it. This morning, to do that with me are two legal practitioners, Daniel Odupe. Welcome.
It's a pleasure to be here.
And Ife, a regular, Ife Oji. It's good to have you guys this morning.
Thank you, Amaka.
All right, so we have several papers this morning for review. We have The Punch, we have This Day, we have The Nation and Vanguard, and of course Complete Sports that we take at the last as the last one. We begin this morning with The Punch newspaper. Federal government wages to rise by 556 billion naira in 3 years. That story, you'll find it on page 28. 90 billion naira poll cash, Oshibajo can't drop immunity, says a senior advocate of Nigeria. That's on page 2. 35 states fail to provide workers insurance on page 25. PDP behind Tinubu, Oshiomhole Erufai's 2023 posters, APC alleging, on page 19. The big story for the Punch newspaper this morning is the federal government suit. Pay $250,000 in 14 days or forget appeal. PNID is saying that on page 2. UK court ties Nigeria's appeal to $200 million security payment. An Irish firm can seize assets if deadlines are missed. The court is saying that. That's the big story there. And then police raid Kaduna home. We have a picture story of that. And free 300 inmates in chains. This story you find on page 12 of the Punch newspaper. We have picture stories also of the same story. And then Kano Group alleges fresh plots to dethrone Emir Sanusi. Please find that on page 12 of the Punch newspaper this morning. And ABU fires 15 workers for sexual harassment and others. Story contained on page 11 of the Punch newspaper. Court disobedience. Sowore wants DSS boss jailed. Find out what Sowore is saying that on page 39. And gunmen kill policeman in Ekiti Bank robbery on page 7. And constituencies, ambulances, transformer recovered from Kashamu's office, ICP says that on page 11. So, Daniel Odupe, there's the big story here of the PNID. Where do you want to begin?
For me, this PNID issues, we need to understand as a people that the business of governance is a serious business. You need to operate it like you're operating a private business. Any delay here and there always have their consequences. I'm excited about this news. I'm really happy that we decided to live up to expectation, to do the right thing, to take it seriously because it's a big deal. It's something that can affect inflow of foreign investment. I mean, already our national, the reserves really drained. We all know that. And now you now have this kind of judgment, you know, hanging over your neck. So for me, I'm excited that we have decided to live up to expectation. But the challenge with this now is that, you know, if we do not, I mean, if we had done the right thing from the beginning, if we had not joked with, court dates and what have you, you know, if there had been due diligence before the signing of the contract and what have you, we will not be where we are today. And right now, the challenges that we are still facing is because we didn't live up to expectation on time. Mm-hmm. And so I think that's the biggest lesson.
Are you also excited that we have $250,000 to pay?
In fact, I've been following the news for a while now, and you know, there are allegations, especially from government quarters, that these guys are basically fraudulent, trying to take advantage of the loopholes in our system. And the truth is that, you know, this might actually be the case, but all evidence is pointing to that direction. Mm-hmm. However, they are able to do that. They're able to even try that because of our lackadaisical attitude, you know. And I just hope that we will continue this momentum, not just in terms of, because, I mean, before this matter came to public consciousness, it has been doing, you know, for years, and, you know, and I suspect that there are several other stuff like this, you know, contracts like this, you know, that are somewhere in the background. And my challenge to the government this morning and to Nigerians is to always put government on the toes. Government needs to live up to expectation. Do not wait till the deadline. Do not wait till, it's almost too little, too late now, because now you have to deposit 20 million for security, you know, that Even if the judgment goes in your favor or against you, you know,
you have that to pay.
Exactly. So, so that's the challenge. We just need to learn to live up to expectation and not wait till the last minute to do the right things.
I agree with what Daniel is saying. Daniel has always, it's always good to look at the, as much as we look at the reality, let's also look at the positive aspect of things as well. At the end of the day, 250 is a 1/50th. Of the amount of the judgment debt to begin with. Mm-hmm. That's nothing compared to what would have been had to pay. Basically, they were asking us to pay what would have amounted to a whole year's budgetary requirement for Nigeria as a nation. Mm-hmm. So having to pay 1/50th is music to the ears of anybody that has in charge of any fiscal has any fiscal authority in this country.
And do you think we're going to meet that in 14 days?
14 days, I'm not sure. I know that they have given us 60 days in its totality. Mm-hmm. The first tranche is meant to be paid in 14 days.
Yes.
I don't think it's something that we cannot handle compared to how much money we're able to take out of the country on a daily basis, even within government. And also, the fact that we have Malami out, we have Emefiele out, all are heavyweights, people making the critical decisions in this country. It's an indication that we're taking it seriously for the first time.
Mm-hmm.
And I don't see how this judgment being set aside is anything but positive news compared to what we're facing had this not happened.
Mm-hmm. So there's a step further to it. Okay, so now please read Kaduna Home, Free 300 Inmates in Chains. That's a story there on page 12. And then Oshibajo can't drop immunity, says senior advocate of Nigeria. I'm aware that you're a legal practitioner. Why is that so?
Oh, well, I think I was privileged to go through that particular report, and I totally agree with. I know that Vice President Oshibajo is trying to do the noble thing here by saying, look, this is a big deal for me. I'm willing to drop my immunity. However, you know, it is really not about him personally. It's about the office. It's about the office, and he need not drop his immunity to be investigated. And I really, you know, subscribe to that and that argument. You know, people in this day and age, especially with social media, people just wake up and say all kinds of things, you know, all manner of things, and then there's so much irresponsibility. And you know, I'm excited that the Vice President is taking this very seriously. People should not just chew, because obviously it's political, it's clearly political, you know, that you know you're just trying to distract, and then maybe for the 2023 polls and whatever. I don't know what the person has in mind, you know. Obviously it was Timothy Fang who said this. So people need to be, you know, if you are saying a thing, you must be willing to back it up with proof. I understand that Timothy Fang has said he's willing
to go to court
and all of that. Mm-hmm. So Vice President Oshibajo need not drop his immunity to challenge this, you know. And he can sue for defamation and what have you, but he cannot be sued without his immunity. He cannot be detained. So all those things they're about the office, they're really not about this person. You know?
Mm-hmm. Now, if EBU fires 15 workers for sexual harassment, in fact, apart from that, there's a lecturer also in the same institution who was demoted for missing scripts. What are your thoughts, generally?
Again, this is a typical situation where you have civil servants, or you have even people that are in public service almost, or giving critical service in Nigeria. In a position where they are not given their, probably not being paid their salaries, they're looking for alternative means, however illegal, to make these monies back and to find some kind of satisfaction in their jobs. And I don't think that the first port of call should be your student or taking advantage of female students. Mm-hmm.
Because nothing justifies, I mean, even if they are not being paid, that nothing justifies such an act.
I would not even begin to dream. I understand why you would say that, because I would not even dream to think that not being paid or not having job satisfaction has any bearing at all on you being a criminal and committing criminal acts.
Mm-hmm.
I think this is just a typical situation where you have found yourself in a position of authority and you are taking full advantage of that position to the detriment of the security and just you're defiling the female student. So we should really take a step back, look at ways to empower the students where they find that they are in this sort of situation. They have recourse to some kind of protection, and that way they can move forward as students and obviously get their degrees without fear of any kind of...
I mean, I must commend the school, the management of Ahmadu Bello University to be able to even do that. You know,
you
can't get away with anything, irrespective of who you are, that is wrong. So please rate Kaduna Home, Free 300 Inmates in Chains. Any thoughts on that?
Really unfortunate news, really. And it just goes to show the kind of challenge we have as a people. You know, and I know that, you know, today is Kaduna, that's places like these, places of worship, you know, that religious centers, that these kind of things are being perpetrated. And this again brings to fore the argument about state policing and other view. If you need a security system that is homegrown, that knows the nook and cranny of a particular place, you know. So I'm excited about this, and it's a good news. It turns up to Nigerian police, and just brings it to fore the issue of state policing. Our security apparatus needs to be ongoing so that things like this can be, because security of life and poverty is a primary responsibility of government.
Mm-hmm. All right, so please grab a copy of the Punch newspaper and find out in details what all of these headlines are about. In the interest of time, we'll actually quickly run to this day. And here, the big story, the first story is PwC reports FG spent 2.3 trillion naira on oil electricity subsidies in 4 years. That story is there on the front page and continued on page 9. And then, citing misconduct, Magu calls for London judge's probe, says jurists desperate to enforce P&ID arbitral award. But you find that story also in, on the front page, but continued on page 8 of this state newspaper. And then the big story is Nigeria to shift battle over $9.6 billion judgment debt to UK appeal court, obtains order saying enforcement of P&ID arbitral award, gets 60 days to pay 200 million deposit to court. And then top down here, down part here, bottom part, it says Ngige, FG can't meet labor's demand on minimum wage. Ify, which one do you want to begin with?
Let's look at the PwC report. Yeah, the PwC, they've, I mean, over the years, PwC has become a force to be reckoned with in terms of providing accurate reports. So we can't, we have to, whenever they produce these reports, mm-hmm. we have to take them very seriously. I mean,
two point three trillion
is not a small figure. I'm sure we all know that. And electricity, for whatever reason, in Nigeria has not been able to be fully has not fully come to fruition in Nigeria, to the point where we have world leaders, we have people like Christine Lagarde and other world leaders coming together during the United Nations General Assembly side event, looking at Africa critically and pointing out Nigeria as a case study mm-hmm. for how we have gotten it wrong. I mean, at the point where you have like world leaders looking at us in that kind of mm-hmm. with those kind of lenses, we know that there's a serious problem. So I think that we just have to find a way to dial ourselves back. I don't think there's been any sort of commercially viable power project. I mean, please correct me if I'm wrong, Daniel, that any viable power project in the last 8 to 12 years, right from when BPE was first established to right now. No, there has been no viable power projects. If anyone can, I challenge anyone, if you know of any power projects that have been viable, channeled through the federal government, please let me know. Mm-hmm. And I, for whatever reason, I feel like there has been systematic ways of stalling these projects and making it so certain that we are still under the care of the state to ensure that we are always found at a power deficit. And it's a bit sad because you find that we have other laws that are promulgated even during the military period where we're actually feeding gas and feeding power and feeding electricity to neighboring states in West Africa. So it begs the question, if we're able to do this, why can't we do that for ourselves? Mm-hmm. So it means that there's systematic, I don't want to say there's a cabal, but that's what typically everyone will say. The systematic institutionalization of the power deficit in Nigeria, and we have to stop this at all costs.
If I may add to what you said, I agree with that. And you know, as a people, we need to also understand how this thing works. Now, because if you look at the report, the report is basically saying that, you know, that we spend so on subsidies, both in terms of oil and electricity. Mm-hmm. Now, as a people, on our own, let's take electricity as an example. Mm-hmm. We power our own, you know, we provide our own power, and we spend probably times three how much you are willing to pay, you know, to those who are supposed to provide it to for us. Do you know what I'm saying? So, as a people, we need to understand that, look, sometimes subsidy is not always a good thing. Mm. It's not, even though we know that okay, things are not so good and, you know, we are managing and what have you, but sometimes it's pays to allow the forces of demand and supply to determine the price. Mm. Because imagine that, you know, you can guarantee, say, 18 hours of power supply, you know, to anybody. That person will totally eliminate the need to, you know, to provide private power in terms of diesel. And then at the end of the day, you're actually saving a lot more. But when you say, oh, you want them to continue to subsidize, and yet you still have a small generator that is still power, if you look at how much you're spending on that, it's probably more. Mm. So we need to be able to balance the people and say, look, what do we really want? Do you want efficiency? And then maybe we need to pay a little. Because the truth is that everybody knows that the cost we are paying right now is not, you know, it's not cost reflective in the sense that it's not, it's not paying any player in that sector to do business. So we need to just ask ourselves those critical questions and find out, how do we want to proceed? Mm. Do you want to maintain subsidy at all costs, or do you want the first of demand supply to determine the price, thereby guaranteeing efficiency?
Very quickly, I must say that yes, electricity is a cause for concern, because even the National Assembly, they've called, you know, the electricity board and some others for interrogation. At least we had that in the news. So we hope that something better will come out from all of this, and then we can see positive change in that dimension. Now, Federal government, according to Ngige, can't meet labor's demand on minimum wage. What are your thoughts generally?
Basically, it's same old story and it's really unfortunate. You know, I'm excited that labor, you know, in Nigeria has been a force to reckon with. However, you know, the dwindling revenue, and for me, to a large extent, I'm sorry, but I would blame the federal government really, because you know, you keep saying you cannot pay minimum wage that the labor is demanding. However, we know the bogus, you know, funds that go into maintaining the civil service. You know, I would have expected, exactly, you know, if you look at, even though the legislatures and, you know, they would deny this, and even the executive denied this, but we know how much goes into, I mean, if you, with the level of poverty in the land, you expect that quality leadership demands that you are a little bit sacrificial, you lead by example.
If you're sensitive. Saying,
exactly, if you should, I mean, I've always advocated, I know that it's really difficult, but I've always advocated, for example, that if you're going to public office, it's a position of service. You know, by your
but that's what all of them say to us. Yes. I'm coming to serve you.
Exactly.
I will deliver.
But the kind of allowances and the stuff that they get doesn't show. I would have expected that they would lead by example and show that, look, we understand the situation. We know how much. If you look at the current budget, for example, over 40% goes into servicing and, you know, mm-hmm. payments of that. And I mean, and then you keep attending the workers that you cannot pay. They will not take you seriously.
Pay them as
you need to lead
30,
by example
30,
by showing that, look, I'm willing to. Because if you are saying you want to serve, that means that at least you're doing well in whatever business you're doing. Because you're supposed to have something you're doing anyways. Mm-hmm. It's not supposed to be a full-time job. You're supposed to be successful in what you're doing. So who would they expect that? They will see that position as a position of service, not you know, going after how much you're going to be paid and all that, being willing to bring it down to a large extent so that we can have enough resources and then the workers can be paid and all that.
Okay, all right. We'll move on now to the Nation newspaper, because the next story is the PNID, which already we've talked about. So we have up for review this morning is the Nation newspaper. Expunge articles experts report, APC tells court. You find that story on page 8 of the Nation newspaper, and police free 300 dumped in Islamic Center. That's on page 7. And court remands FBI fraudster in Ilorin. Ambulances recovered from Kashamo on page 10. How Navy Chief's murder was planned. That's on page 4. Omeruo Awaziem for Brazil friendly. Something on spot there on page 46. Now, no crack in the presidency, says APC governors. And Nigeria lost 1.57 billion to illicit financial flows between 23 to 2012, says Buhari. Mm-hmm. You find that on page 31 of the Nation newspaper. And again, their big story is the UK court stays execution on PNID's $9.6 billion judgment. Federal government to deposit $200 million. Sorry, and Judge Oke's request to appeal verdict. Buhari world leaders mourn ex-president, that's a French president, Jacques Chirac. And that's all of this you find on the front page, but continued on page 7. And the Osun chides ASU over Lautec on page 42. And government to reconstitute minimum wage panel. That's on page 8. So, basically, the same story is running across. What are your thoughts on any of this?
There's also the African Continental Free Trade.
Yeah, there is, but not on this. We'll get to that. This is the Nation newspaper. Yeah, it's somewhere.
Concerning no crack in presidency, where, you know, it's good that the APC government are trying to, you know, maintain a good image, because it's not good for the party anyway. There's mm-hmm. any lift, but evidence that we're seeing is not suggesting, you know, it's not supporting what they're saying. I just hope that there's really no lift.
You're not completely agreeing with this.
Exactly. So just because we need them to be working together. We don't need, you know, a house divided against itself cannot stand. So, mm-hmm. so we really hope that, you know, that, you know, whatever issues that may exist, you know,
they'll be able to be sorted.
Exactly, absolutely.
Okay, please grab a copy of the Nation newspaper, as we have said, and find out for yourself all the details. And so we'll move on to the Vanguard, that's where the after story is. So the big story there again is $9.6 billion award. UK court halts execution OK's appeal. We already know. Ask FG to pay $200 million security for stay of execution. Don't negotiate with PNID. Margo warns, insists it's fraud. Now, fraud allegation against us, a red herring, PNID is saying. And then we have the federal government sees 8% export expansion under AFTA. That's on page 19. No rift between Buhari and Oshibajo, APC governors declare. That's on page 9. Policeman killed, millions scattered away as robbers attack bank in Ekiti with explosives. That's on page 6. You find that story. And Nigeria lost $159.5 billion to illicit financial flows in 9 years, Buhari says. Despite meeting bail conditions, DSS is yet to release Sowore, says Falana on page 8. Again, Southern Middle Belt leaders reject Ruger on page 11. And reps probe power expenditure from 1999. That's on page 9. Ify, I know you want to say something on AFTA.
Yes, that is a buzzword amongst all the multilaterals, all the international organizations. Everybody is talking about the Continental Free Trade Area. Mm-hmm. Is this possible? We don't know. Has it been signed? Yes, it has been. Every country in Africa has signed it apart from Eritrea. And we are in the next couple of years, we're hoping that we'll find ourselves where Africa is one trading block, with all the small and medium-sized businesses in Africa gaining potentially 50% markup on their customer base. Mm-hmm. So the question is, from what Oshibajo is saying, is it going to be possible for us to have export expansion? That is a key question, because right now, one of the biggest hold-up to AFTA is the idea that we do not have proper infrastructure to support it. So you find that for us to have manufacturing at its optimal, we have to make sure that our infrastructure are put in place, especially in Nigeria, if we're going to be competitive with the rest of the world. The question is, in the first place, should we even go into AFTA in the first place as Nigeria? Because we are seen as giants of Africa. Let's be honest. We're not trying to be the typical arrogant big brother of the continent. But the truth is, the truth is that there's 200 million of us. And if we make up 15% of the entire African population, we are also, as well, the biggest economy in Africa. I mean, followed by maybe, I would say, South Africa and Egypt. So if you add those three countries together, we make up more than 50% of the entire GDP of Africa. But I mean, from what Oshibajo is purporting right now, we can be, I mean, the way you can spin it is you can say that we are the gateway of commerce or trade in Africa. Mm-hmm. So that way we're not left behind. And it's a good thing that even though we were kicking and screaming, we actually ended up signing AFTA. And hopefully we'll see the benefits and fruits of the labor in the next couple of years.
Okay, very quickly. Mm-hmm. Yes, because
it just again brings to fore the need for us to put our own in order, to ensure that, you know, we manage ourselves well, because at the end of the day, you know, we might be at the losing end if we do not do those things, and then we have signed, we are in need now. Mm-hmm. It may end up being just dumping ground basically for goods and services produced in another part of the continent.
But the main issue is that we're actually, the whole reason of having AFTA in the first place is that there will be those sort of
we're going to cut you. Thank you, Ify and Daniel. We would like to continue this conversation, but in the interest of time, we'll have to move on. Thank you guys for coming be with us this morning.
Right.
And that's where we'll wrap this program off the press. And we will begin next week, Monday, as we have it only on weekdays. See you again. Thank you very much. Here on Plus TV Africa, I am Amaka Okoye.